Welcome to Critical Thought TV. I'm your host, Stuart Dambrot. We're here with Ben Goertzel, a self-proclaimed cosmist and singularitarian, the CEO of Novamenti and BioMind, and the chief science officer of Idea Holdings, as well as the chairman of the Artificial General Intelligence Society and the Open Cog Foundation. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
It is so my pleasure to have you here. It's great. Okay. What happens after the singularity? I mean, this is an open question. We're not even going to get into the fact or the debate about whether it's going to happen or not, or if Ray is accurate enough, or any of that. Let's assume, if you will, that it is coming. The timeline is roughly accurate, 20 to 30 years, something to that effect. But even if that's not the case, what happens in a post-singularity environment, in your view?
When Werner Vinge first proposed the concept of the technological singularity, the way he put it was, after this point, we just don't know what's going to happen.
Well,
because
that was, Rainbow's End in the 80s, I think. I believe it was in that science fiction novel.
Rainbow's End was a more recent novel.
Yeah.
Is it Marooned in Real Time, perhaps?
Perhaps that was it.
Anyway, Werner Vinge's vision of the singularity was a point after which we can have no idea what's going to happen. Ray Kurzweil has put forward a sort of kinder, gentler view. He seems to see the singularity more as kind of like life as it is now, but without any shortages of energy or health, without a limited lifespan, with all the goodies we want. I tend more toward the Vingian side of singularitarianism. I tend to think a singularity is likely to happen, and it's going to be a radical discontinuity. It's hard for us to predict what comes afterwards. But as well as a singularitarian, I consider myself a cosmist. What this means is that I don't identify. What this means is that I don't identify myself purely as a human being living in human society. I am that, and humanity is important to me. But I also envision myself as a sort of citizen of the universe, as a certain stage in the development of intelligence and life, going from long before humans and long into the future. I think human beings are important, but I think the whole intelligence of the universe is important, including radically transhuman things that may go far beyond anything we can understand now.
It reminds me a little bit of Randall Kuhn's universal Darwinism and looking very far down the road when he talks about substrate independence, but that could be not what you're going after at all, but it just reminded me of it.
Universal Darwinism is one perspective, looking at the evolution of the universe as a sort of survival of the fittest, on and on, far beyond human beings. I'm not sure whether that's the best metaphor. Biological evolution may not be the best way to think about what happens after you have superhuman AIs that can reconfigure matter according to their will. Evolution is more about competing organisms struggling for resources, in a sense, whereas once you have superhuman AGIs ruling the roost, the opportunity for them to exchange information between their own minds with each other may mean it's more like one big AGI mind rather than a bunch of independent entities competing with each other. In the case that it's more like one big cosmic, cosmist, universal mind network, the whole way of thinking of Darwinian evolution may not be relevant.
One
of the more interesting speculations about post-singularity intelligence was put forward by my friend John Smart. He wrote a paper called the Transcension Hypothesis. And this is kind of an interesting hypothesis. You have to follow the reasoning. We can already see in the recent evolution of technology that computer chips are getting smaller and smaller. Technology is being miniaturized, right? And
right.
Nanotechnology is often seen as the ultimate extension of that. Actually, nanotech is for wimps. Femtotechnology is going to be much more interesting. That's building things out of elementary particles. take neutrons, protons, gluons, intermediate vector bosons, build stuff besides boring old atoms, build new forms of degenerate matter out of these particles. Why would you want to do that? Well, the same reason that we have miniaturized electronics so far. Special relativity, Einstein's theory of special relativity, says information can't go faster than the speed of light. So, if you want to be really, really smart, you want to get smaller and smaller so your components can communicate more rapidly among each other. But what's the ultimate extension of that? First of all, it's femtotechnology, building stuff out of particles. Secondly, it's an increasing density of your computing elements. You want to pack more and more particles closer and closer together in larger and larger bulk to get a very dense, massive computing core that can communicate among itself incredibly fast. That's how you want to go if you want to make something maximally intelligent, which is probably what a post-singularity mind is going to want to do. But what happens when you get something really, really big and really dense? It becomes a black hole.
Yes, it does. Eventually.
This is one possibility. A post-singularity intelligence makes itself such a powerful computer, it becomes a black hole, shuts itself off from the rest of us. That's a very interesting potential solution to the Fermi paradox. Physicist Enrico Fermi's question, where are all the aliens out there? Why aren't they sending us radio messages? Well, the answer may be, when an alien civilization reaches the level of technology that would enable it to send radio messages, within a couple hundred years after that, it reaches a singularity, it compresses itself and becomes a black hole. Goodbye. On the other hand, there's the possibility that different black holes may be connected by quantum wormholes.
Or Einstein-Rosen bridges.
Exactly. You may have various kinds of tunneling between black holes. In that case, what we could have in the universe is a bunch of black holes containing superhuman intelligences from species that have passed their singularities, connecting by quantum tunneling, Einstein messaging.
It would be quantum tunneling, you know, which since entanglement and quantum tunneling are features of the quantum realm.
Sure.
And these black hole AGIs would be also quasi-particles,
It's quantum gravity tunneling.
Yes, yes.
It's wormholes through space-time. There's also quantum theory involved. It's an interesting speculation. What it would mean is that there's this other aspect of the universe of compressed superintelligences living inside black holes, communicating through some kind of gravitational / quantum wormhole thingies, and then all of us idiots who haven't reached the singularity yet are out here in the rest of the universe.
And we can presume that even a couple of months ago, there were three separate research papers showing how it's possible using reversible algorithms to extend the life of coherence, so that the ability to avoid entanglement death. That's right now.
If you're talking about femtotech, if you're talking about advanced AGIs that have figured out how to dispense with atoms and assemble elementary particles into new kinds of intelligent quark gluon plasma or whatnot, I would imagine that quantum coherence could be maintained over large, massive, complex objects in that kind of scenario, potentially even having the same degenerate matter tunneling through curved space-time, maintaining its quantum resonance between different black holes. This is all complete wild-ass speculation.
But it makes sense to me. I mean, it's Stargate AGI-1. Right?
Yeah, what it indicates is that there could be a lot of things beyond Terminator robots stomping around on the Earth or any kind of anthropomorphic AGI that we're thinking of. Now, we have to bear in mind that physics has revised its fundamental theory of the universe every 50 or 100 years or so. So it may well be that by the time we get to the singularity, we won't have these same ideas about black holes and tunnels through curved space-time and so forth anyway. It may be something even far wilder and stranger that we can't even imagine. But I do think it's important not to constrain ourselves to an anthropomorphic view of post-singularity AGI. How could we ever understand the thoughts of some quark gluon plasma with 88 quintillion times more the processing power of humanity distributed among multiple black holes through these tunnels.
I mean, that are space-time irrelevant, that are completely decoupled from space-time.
It may be able to reshape space-time locally as part of its thought process.
And if you, especially if you subscribe rather to the particle physics view of forces in gravity, but the Einsteinian geodesic as a confirmational feature of space-time in the vicinity of mass, then in fact you would expect that. You would expect it to, and since it's a conscious entity as well, that would be, I think, not a necessary, but a highly probable outcome.
Well, go a little further out there even. Now, Kurt Goertzel, the famous mathematician, he also dabbled in physics, and he showed there's a solution to Einstein's space-time equations that would allow you to travel backwards in time. If space-time were curved the way that Kurt Goertzel said, you could fly this direction.
Right.
Eventually, you would come back where you started, but earlier. Now,
imagine you had an AGI
that could reshape local space-time inside its personal black hole to enable this kind of curvature. Then it could be going around in causal time loops of backward time travel.
And you know what else there could be? There could be then, you know, the hypothetical. Entity of negative energy, right, which could be used in principle if it exists and if it could be enough could be collected, if you will, in a certain constrained space. It could be used to expand and contract space-time at will. So it would be like in Dune, traveling without moving.
There you go. There's a lot of possibilities out there. My hope is that if there are human beings who, post-singularity, want to remain in the classic legacy human form with all this meat and hair and all these cognitive limitations, my hope is that these humans will be permitted to do so, just as we now have ants and bacteria swarming around the Earth. But for those humans who choose not to do that, for those humans who choose to upload their minds into computers, for those humans who choose to fuse with the machines, which are becoming more and more palpable possibilities as technology progresses. Actually, I just edited a special issue of a journal on mind uploading. It's the first journal issue on mind uploading with contributions by all these serious scientists, the Journal of Machine Consciousness.
Ah, Randall has his paper
That's right. So
yeah.
For those who embrace these concepts, want to upload their minds and fuse with AGIs, and progressively increase their intelligence far beyond the human level, we really can't see what the limit is now. The point of all these physics speculations is just the sky is not even the limit. It's, as Vinja thought, it's going to be far beyond what we can comprehend.
Thank you so very much.